We've talked a lot about the different kinds of motorcycles, from cruisers to e-bikes, but today we're taking a look at something a little different. Concept motorcycles, that's right. Every manufacturer loves to come up with crazy concepts to show off what's happening behind the scenes and keep people interested in the future of the brand, but 9 times out of 10, the wild concepts that get shown off at trade shows like EICMA never see the light of day. If you want to buy bikes that actually look like their concepts, you normally need to look up smaller companies, the ones that are trying to make a name for themselves on the back of one super expensive, crazy looking bike. But otherwise, we can all pine over what might have been. We'll start out today by taking a look at concepts from our usual suspects, then branch out into some wild and crazy bikes from car manufacturers or just people with more money than sense that wanted to try to make a motorcycle. The only rule for this list is that the bikes must have never entered production, much like our beloved and forever missed Turbo Gen 3 Hayabusa. Now, before I get too far into this one, I've got to shout out our new intermediate bike that we're giving away, the Indian FTR 1200S. That thing is basically a concept bike come to life, and man, does it rip. We've got a whole bunch of stuff planned for this bike, but as you know, we can't keep it. It is a giveaway bike. So if you want to get entered to win, one of the best ways to do it is click the link down below and check out ynmoto.co. We're selling all kinds of gear and parts for your ride. We've got beginner gear all the way up to top shelf Orai helmets, tools, and tons of tire options. And every dollar you spend is an entry to win. All you have to do is select your sweepstakes to get entered. Click that link down below and get yourself all the goodies you need to ride and get entered to win this sweet FTR all at the same time. What are you waiting for? We're gonna start off with perhaps our least interesting conceptual motorcycle, which is a bummer considering who it's from. It's the Ducati Dragster, or Drag-X-ter. In typical Ducati fashion, they showed off the concept in 2016 with the reveal of the X-Diavel, which is a more relaxed cruisery version of the Diavel. The whole point of the Dragster was to make a, you guessed it, drag racing version of the 1262cc muscle bike. The version they showed off had no lights, no plate, no indicators. It was a fully stripped back bike built for crushing in a straight line at a drag strip. Don't believe me? It had a car tire in the back for all the grips. It's actually not too dissimilar from what Harley did with the V-Rod Destroyer back in the day, and it was a completely hopped up factory version of the V-Rod that cost an arm and a leg, and not the usual Harley arm and a leg either. Built to rip quarter miles all day long. For some reason, Ducati put the Panigale's brakes and suspension components on the Dragster, which is weird. Maybe they just needed a lower suspension and they had a spare $10,000 set of forks lying around, but Ducati's gonna Ducati, I suppose. Ducati fans are still maintaining that the Dragster will see the light of day, but with the new S stealing the black and yellow colorway, we can assume that the Dragster is officially dead. It's also not Ducati's style. No matter how much money you spend at the Ducati dealership, you're always getting a road-legal motorcycle, even if the $150,000 Superleggera you just bought would be better served as a track-day only tool. Number two comes to us from BMW, and it's the last of the practical concept motorcycles, read boring, the Urban Racer. It's what you get when you pay a 3D modeler to make your R9T look like a sport bike. Don't get me wrong, it looks cool, but in a completely predictable sort of way. You've got the exposed heads poking out through the fairings like you'd expect from a Beamer, the usual crazy headlight that signals to the world, this is a concept bike, and seats that look like someone stuck a baseball mitt on the tail and called it a day. We do see some proper upside down suspension that's solidly beefy, dual disc brakes, and some proper sport bike tires, but considering that this bike doesn't even have a physical version, there's really not much to talk about. It's basically R9T fanfic. Number three on our first crazy contraption of the morning, the Yamaha Tesseract. It's like if an R1 and a quad swapped Busa got drunk and procreated. It's a motorcycle. Kinda, in the sense that it's got handlebars, a twist throttle, and gears that you shift with your feet, and it's got standard sport bike rubber on it. But it's got four wheels, each with its own swing arm and suspension. Looking at it, I can see why Yamaha never greenlit the Tesseract, seeing as how it would probably be a nightmare to ride, but it was pitched as a leaning four-wheeler. In the past, Yamaha had worked on a bike called the OR2T, which was another leaning four-wheeler, but the two wheels sat right next to each other, so it was basically a motorcycle with a super wide contact patch. The Tesseract is a more modern version of that design, with the wheels a little farther apart for a meaner look. However, unlike the OR2T, the Tesseract was never actually tested on the road. However, you can see technology from the OR2T and the Tesseract in other projects Yamaha has brought to market, like the Nikon and the Tri-City scooter. Serious question though, would you consider the Tesseract a motorcycle or a quad? Let me know down below. Number four comes to us from the most risk-averse Japanese manufacturer, Suzuki. Or maybe they're not risk averse, maybe they just don't care or don't want to try, but that wasn't always the case. Back in 2005, Suzuki unveiled a bike called the Stratosphere, which was an 1100cc inline six cross between a sport touring bike and a naked bike. Of all of their concepts on this list, there was the one that actually looked like it was ready to ride, and that's because it was. Much like the B-King, the Stratosphere was dead on arrival thanks to a release window during the 2008 financial crisis. We don't have a ton of information about the bike, but we do have some claimed power figures. Apparently it was rated at 180 horsepower and 100 foot-pounds of torque. Somehow they managed to make the engine smaller than the Busa's engine, and thanks to lack of fairings and Busa Boy accoutrement, it would have been a lot lighter. In typical dad bike fashion, the bike had adjustable windscreen, handlebars, and a GPS system, switchable manual and automatic transmission, but that would have come at a crazy premium that most people just couldn't afford at the time. My hunch is that they still have this bike kicking around at the factory because rumor has it at one point a flat six Busa was in development. I'd bet my bottom dollar it was a version of this bike. Suzuki was at the finish line with the Stratosphere, so we'll have to see if it ever comes back. Number five, sticking with Suzuki, we've got one from the 80s when everyone was too busy doing cocaine and designing motorcycles to worry about the balance sheet, the Falco Rustico. Falco Rustico? I have no idea how we're supposed to say it. This one was completely bananas. Concept bike. Looking like something that rolled right out of a cyberpunk anime, the Falco Rustico featured a square 4 two-stroke engine and two-wheel drive. It didn't have chains or shafts driving the wheels either. Instead, it was going to have a hydraulic pump system to spin the wheels, with both the front and the rear wheels having swing arms. It was also going to be steered with joysticks, apparently, which is even more baffling. My favorite description of the bike comes from Hell for Leather, where they said, "How on earth any of this seemed a 1990s feasibility in 1985 is beyond us. We're guessing that they also envisioned aluminum foil hats and hover houses." Ludicrous impracticality aside, I love the look of the Falco Rustico. I could even see the bike that Deckard rolled around on in Blade Runner, or maybe even Murphy's bike in RoboCop. But alas, the world would never actually get to see one roll down the road. Number four, the KTM Ion. This is one that probably is the most likely to actually see the light of day on this list, but it's still a really weird looking concept regardless. It's a cross between an electric push bike and a motorcycle, with no pedals and a proper dual disc motorcycle brakes up front and a massive rotor in the back, but with road brake handlebars and a tiny little seat. It's got a substantial frame that looks like it was pulled right off the 690/701 platform, and it's packing a massive electric motor. We don't have the specs for power on this bike, but if I were a betting man, I'd say this thing is going to be right in line with your average 125cc scooter or Grom. The perfect around the town kind of vehicle for someone who needs a cheap transportation. Here's the question though. Scooters and Groms require registration, safety inspection, and the MSF course to ride. With the Ion blurring the line between e-bike and electric motorcycle, I wonder where it would fall in terms of regulation. One thing I appreciate about this concept is the inclusion of proper motorcycle brakes and wider tires. It's really easy for manufacturers to pump a lot of power into a little package and forget to improve the braking performance to match. My hope is that the Ion makes e-bike people realize that riding a motorized bicycle can be just as risky as riding a motorcycle, and they should actually wear protective gear. Number three, the Ferrari V4. A red tube with wheels. Seriously, look at it and tell me it's not just a red paper towel with wheels. Designed in the early 2000s, this bike was actually never built, and it probably for good reason. It was designed by a man named Amir Glinic, independently of Ferrari, so much like the BMW Superbike, it's purely fan fiction, but it's still a pretty interesting design. The goal was to use a V4 version of the Enzo V12 on a ride-by-wire system, which was still in its infancy in 2006 when the first concept drawn up. It featured bell-style brake rotors, which were mounted to the outside of the rim. Having ridden a Buell with that style rotor, I'm not sure I see the point other than having added expense and complexity, but I have a feeling that Glinic didn't have a firm grasp on how motorcycles actually worked. So as not to disturb the lines of the bike, the dashboard was in a weatherproof window between the handlebars, and it was intended to be at a touch screen. Now, I'm not one to stifle creativity, but this bike not needed to be made. It would have been a rolling travesty. Its wheelbase is too long, the riding position is beyond aggressive, and could you imagine having to take all those seamless fairings off the bike in order to work on a Ferrari engine? I don't know if we were in any danger of this one seeing the light of day, but you never know. Italian car manufacturers have a lot of spare time on their hands. Number two goes back to the big four with the Kawasaki J concept, a bike that they refused to let die. They first showed it off at the 2013 Tokyo Motor Show, and then again in 2018 and 19. The second reveal or tease of the bike came with a lovely little CG trailer showing a badly animated G.I. Joe villain riding around on the bike and shouting commands at an onboard AI, and the bike literally changing shape as it was rolling down the road, switching from an aggressive sport bike setup to a cruiser or a naked bike setup, and then back. Now, I know that's ridiculous and will probably never happen, but we can all take a moment and imagine how horrifying that would be the first time you're rolling down the road and you feel your bike transforming underneath you. Yeah, hard pass. But yeah, how do you know it'll never happen? Easy. They were using voice commands in the video. When have those worked ever in the history of ever? Try asking your Alexa to order something right now. I bet you you're not 100% that your little NSA wet dream device didn't accidentally order you a box full of discount vibrators. Anyways, back to the J concept. They actually made a physical version of it, though it doesn't do the Transformers thing. As it stands right now, it's a weird-looking three-wheeled movie prop, but who knows? Kawasaki's not busy making bikes for MotoGP because they're too scared, so they gotta find some other way to hold their interest, I suppose. Last up today is the Moto Scissors 1, and I chose this one to take the top spot because he's basically a Polish Eric Buell, and I have a soft spot for the auteur motorcycle manufacturers out there. Michael Scissors, the man behind the bike, wanted to design a perfectly balanced engine, so he came up with two counter-rotating crankshafts. Basically, it's an inline four with the left two pistons spin on one crank that rotates clockwise, and the other two spin on a separate crank spinning the opposite direction. Clear as mud? Essentially, what it means is that there's no need for balancing shafts anywhere on the engine because the pistons cancel each other out, and the two rotating cranks cancel out the other forces. Perfectly balanced, as all things should be. What's crazy about this one is that Moto Scissors was ready to start racing in MotoGP in 2007, but the engine they had designed was too big, with FIM and Dorna setting the capacity limits at the time for 800cc and the C1 having a 990cc in line 4, so they set their sights on AMA and World Superbike instead. Considering that no one had heard of them, it goes to show you how well that dalliance in racing actually went. Still, it's crazy to imagine that some complete underdog, no-name manufacturer throwing their hat into GP. It's hard to imagine that nowadays. Fact. Staff members of the Slovak and Slovenian embassies meet once a month to exchange incorrectly addressed mail. Goodbye.
Ah, bummer for you, my little squid, this video is actually over. But lucky for you, there's plenty of other Yammie videos you can check out right over here. What's gonna happen to them? I don't know. I haven't seen them. But you can watch them right now.